Hola, and welcome to the reinforcement learning tutorial number one. My name is Eric DeWitt, and I am a research associate at the Fundação Champalimau here in Lisbon, Portugal. I'm also co-chair of Neuromatch Academy's Executive Committee and Projects Committee, and so it's a great pleasure to talk to you today. I'm going to talk to you about a little bit of the relationship between reinforcement learning and neurobiology, but first let's start with a question. Why is reinforcement learning interesting to us as computational neuroscientists at all? Well, first, there are very few examples of neural activity that almost exactly match a theoretical prediction. So let's start with a little bit of history. Reinforcement learning has its roots in the 1890s with Pavlov's work in physiology and the animal learning research of the 1900s. In the 1920s, 30s, and 40s, this work continued to grow, and in the 50s and 60s and 70s, there was work done to formalize it and additional contributions from statistical learning theory and operations research. As Doina said this morning in the introductory lecture, reinforcement learning is the intersection of many fields. But it was in the late 1980s and early 1990s that Richard Sutton and Andrew Bartow and colleagues formalized reinforcement learning while keeping the roots close to the neurobiology and behavior. And they wrote the book on reinforcement learning called An Introduction to Reinforcement Learning, and I highly recommend it. At the same time, Wolfram Schultz's laboratory was studying dopamine's role in action and its effects on the motor system when they noticed that dopamine also responded to motivations, or rewards, and surprise. So in these classic studies, a monkey was sitting with its paw resting on a key, and there was a food box that would light up. And sometimes there would be an apple inside, and the monkey was being trained to reach inside and touch the food box. At the beginning, when the animal didn't know that there was going to be an apple there, the dopamine neurons would not activate at the time the light came on. But after the animal learned that when it reached inside, sometimes it would get an apple, the dopamine neurons started responding at the time the light came on, even before reaching up to get the food. At the same time, in the late 1990s, Peter Diane and Reed Montague first successfully modeled the honeybee's octopamine neuron during classical conditioning as a reward prediction error. They realized that the dopamine activity observed by Schultz was also consistent with a reward prediction error. Since then, thousands of papers have confirmed the basic relationship between reward prediction error and dopamine activity. Recent work, of course, has provided evidence that the story is more complicated, but this long connection between behavior, neural activity, and reinforcement learning has proved immensely powerful, and it's a framework that really allows us to think about how the whole brain might work together to produce actions. But let's start with dopamine and classical conditioning. As you've heard this morning, in reinforcement learning, an agent takes an action, it interacts with the environment, and the environment returns a reward and a state signal when you arrive in a new state. Here, we don't even need the action. We're just going to consider how to calculate future expected value when you know that a reward may be coming. Again, from this morning's lecture, we understand that the value function of a state is incremented by taking the reward you receive and the new value of the new state discounted by a discount factor and subtract the current value of the state you left. And this becomes a reward prediction error, or the difference between what you expected to get and what you actually got. We then adjust the estimate of the future value using a learning rate, which makes the reward prediction error small or large, depending on how fast we want to learn. So what does this mean if we were to look for a signature of a reward prediction error in dopamine neurons? Well, when the animal has not any experience, it has no expectations. Here plotted on the left is a raster plot of dopamine neurons. The conditioned stimulus, or CS, is at the left, and the reward is indicated by a line. And you'll see that when the reward arrives and the animal isn't expecting it, the dopamine neurons fire. If we were to look at a reinforcement learning model, what we would see is that the reward, shown here in yellow, arrives at the time indicated after the drop of water or the piece of apple. There is no estimate of future value, or V. And delta, or the reward prediction error, also occurs at the time of reward because it wasn't expected. After learning, the conditioned stimulus comes to predict the future reward. So when the conditioned stimulus arrives, you weren't expecting a reward, but the conditioned stimulus tells you you'll get one. And at the time of reward, you were already expecting the reward, so there's no more prediction error. In the model, what that means is there's a prediction error at the time of the cue, And then you have a value function that gives you the estimated future value until you arrive at the time of reward. Of course, if the reward is omitted, you still have the reward prediction error at the time of the CS, but you no longer have a reward, and so there's actually a negative reward prediction error at the time the reward was expected. If we were to think about this during learning, we can plot the 3D space of the reward prediction error. So plotted along this axis is time, or states, as we're going to see in a second. And plotted along this axis is the number of the trial, or we could say in reinforcement learning terms, the episode number. At the beginning of learning, the reward prediction errors are at the end of the trial. And at the end of learning, the reward prediction errors occur at the beginning of the trial. Of course, they also indicated in this simulation a negative reward prediction error due to an omission. We can also look at the evolution of the value function over time, and we see that it rises up and indicates, as you go through more episodes, that the value is being expected further and further back in time. To model this, we're going to use something called a tap delay line. A tap delay line is basically a trial, capturing all of the states as though you were progressing through them, representing time. So the queue and time are combined into this series of states. And there's a terminal state at the end which provides a reward. We've provided you with a classical conditioning Python class, which you'll use for your tutorial today. In exercise one, you will use this classical conditioning task to understand the tap delay line representation, observe changes in the value function, observe the predicted reward prediction error, and replicate and understand these basic biological observations of dopamine. Look forward to seeing you on the other side.